topic is VMware fault tolerance. Okay, what is the significance of fault tolerance? Fault tolerance, guys. Any idea? Okay, see, VMware vSphere fault tolerance provides continuous availability for applications with up to 4 virtual CPUs. Means if your hardware is having 128 CPU, it's okay, doesn't matter. This FT will work if you have a maximum 4 CPUs. But if your system is having 8 CPU or 16 virtual CPUs or maybe 6 virtual CPUs, it won't work. That's a limitation. Okay. So let's understand how it works. Before we go and discuss about fault tolerance, let's talk about Windows failover cluster. I have two servers. Okay. Two Windows servers. What I did, I have created failover cluster on top of this. And what I did, I have allocated some SAN storage. Imagine these are physical servers, or even if it is a virtual server, it's fine. Okay, I have allocated some SAN storage to both the machines. Right? Now in this scenario, C drive and C drive both are C drives are local drives. Local drives in the sense, maybe local VMDKs and stuff. Rest D, E, F, and G, whatever the drives are there, the data drives, they are from SAN. So what happens if failover cluster is configured, and currently if this is primary and this is secondary. Imagine scenario is something primary and secondary. All these drives were mounted over here. If there is any problem with this host or this virtual machine or this physical server, whatever, if this primary host goes down, automatically these drives will be mounted here and applications start connecting to here. Okay, you getting my point? So that as far as the application is concerned at the front end, there is no downtime for the application. But what we did, we have put some anti-affinity rules in VMware saying primary, secondary should not be on the same host, because if the main host goes down, both your primary, secondary will be gone. So just to protect that, we defined some anti-affinity rule. That's a different story when we are discussing about DRS. Okay, now what FT will do, FT will also give you similar kind of functionality. There is no downtime. Okay, so what they're saying here, let's look at. Provides continuous availability for applications. Continuous availability for applications means no downtime. Remember, if there is a downtime, then you call it as a HA. Okay, so let's take simple scenario to test. I have three hosts, right, in my lab. Okay, previously you remember when we are doing HA and DRS test, I have a couple of virtual machines on each of these. Just a moment. Yeah, sorry, let's go. So imagine During the HA and DRS testing, we have a couple of virtual machines, right? Okay. Now, can you tell me some of the prerequisites for HA? I'm writing once again. Remember, this is third time or fourth time I'm writing these details. So be careful. It is very important. Okay, prerequisite for HA. For HA,
Center.
VC. I'm writing in short forms. Okay, in vCenter you need a cluster.
Cluster.
Okay, enable HA.
Totally.
And shared storage.
Sorry.
This is for HA.
It.
DRS, for DRS you need above all plus vMotion kernel port. Agree on this? Okay, means if you want to configure HA, these are the prerequisites. If you want to configure the DRS, you need above all HA, you can disable it. Okay, still DRS will work. You're getting my point? If you want to disable HA and enable
Yes.
DRS, it's fine, it will work. DRS will work. But if you want to enable the DRS, and if you want to enable the DRS, you need to have additionally one kernel port for vMotion. That is a requirement. Along with that, you also need vCenter, cluster, proper network, shared storage. You need all these things, and additionally kernel port. Fine. So when it comes to FT, you need FT logging kernel port. You getting my point? You need all these things. You need all these things. Plus, if you want to enable FT logging kernel port, additional one more kernel port is required. Understood? Or any confusion? So, if I disable HA and enable DRS, does it work? DRS will work or not?
If we
I'm
disable
on.
HA,
I have all the
then
features.
DRS will work.
I have
Yes,
all the
it will work.
features. Okay, if I disable HA and enable DRS, will the DRS will work or not?
Yes, it will work.
Okay, if I disable DRS, only enable HA, will that work?
Yes. Yeah, it
So
will work.
in HA and DRS, where you will enable and disable? At cluster level.
Cluster level.
At cluster level, you will enable or disable HA DRS. Fine. But when it comes to fault tolerance is enabled or disabled at virtual machine level, not at a cluster level. Okay. So remember, let me go to other dashboard. So I have a cluster. Okay. Inside the cluster, I have one host. Inside the host, I have one virtual machine. If I want to enable FT on top of this, FT is VM level feature, remember. Okay, at cluster level, it is recommended that HA and DRS must be enabled. These two must be enabled. Plus, enable the FT at VM level. You understood the logic? At cluster level, at host level, at VM level. Right? Cluster level, these two must be configured. At host level, you need to create one kernel port called FT logging. fault tolerance logging, and at VM level enable fault tolerance. Clear? These are the things you have to make sure. Confused? Or you're getting what I'm saying? Okay. So what it will do? Yeah, what it will do? Let's understand. Imagine I have a cluster with three hosts and there is a data store, right? Just a data store, I'm sorry. Right, there are three data stores in SAN. Everything is attached to all my host. Now, where these VMs will sit? On the shared data store. Agree? Okay, shared data store.
Yeah.
Now you have two kernel ports here. One kernel port is for management. Another kernel port is for what purpose? For what purpose?
VMotion.
VMotion.
DRS.
VMotion. Okay, VMotion. That will be used for DRS. So there are two more kernel ports, boss. Don't forget, iSCSI 1, iSCSI 2. You're getting my point? Now,
yes.
For leave about those four kernel ports, I need one more additional kernel port for FTE. You getting what I'm saying? Okay.
How many kernel ports? Single VM. If we have two or three VMs in a single host in FE, you will require two, three ports.
No. So please, listen. So you cannot enable all the VMs with FE. There is a limitation. Okay, I guess on a whole cluster you can enable around 32 or 16 some FE VMs across the cluster. Okay, if you go to maximums. Total number of FT VMs on a cluster. How many FT VMs that you can run on a cluster? There is a limitation. Okay. But one kernel port is enough. I have enabled FT on this. I have enabled FT on this. These two can communicate via FT kernel port and send the data. Okay. Why you need FT kernel port? When you enable, remember how it works. Concentrate. Okay. When you enable FT on this VM. Enable FT on this VM. Remember primary secondary concept. Treat this as a primary. Okay. Treat this as a primary. And when you enable FT, it will create a secondary somewhere in other host. How many hosts? 64 host will be there. One host is there, another 63 hosts are available in the same cluster. It will go and create secondary somewhere. You getting my point? And it has kernel port here as well, fault tolerance. Okay, this kernel port is connected and this kernel port is connected. Both are connected in one switch. One switch. So if you enable, this VM is sitting here. This VM is sitting here. Okay. Now, normally, how the user will connect? How the user will connect? User over the internet, the request came in and it will come. Here you'll have some distributed switch and user will access the data like this. Agree? Okay, so he start putting some data. He started putting some data. So this data is saved here. Okay, what FT will do? Same data, it will replicate via FT kernel port to secondary machine. It will be saved here. Okay, if what happens if you shut down this whole this VM, this will not become secondary. Okay, if you shut down this VM, it will not become secondary. It is not the aim. You are shutting down means you are manually doing it. There is no problem in it. There is no failure in it. Okay, so when HA will occur, because at cluster level HADRs both are configured, right? When HA will come into picture, when there is any hardware failure. Imagine this server hardware failure event occurred. In the sense, this host is failed. So obviously these three VMs will go offline or not?
Yes.
Okay, when these three VMs will go offline, okay, application will go and connect to this will automatically become a primary. You getting my point? So no downtime, only one ping loss will be there, and automatically application start functioning. So the primary is down, secondary has become a primary. Now what HA will do after 3 minutes or 5 minutes, it will pick all these three VMs and it will restart the red ones. It will restart the red ones here and it will restart the blue one here, because primary and secondary, you should not keep both in a single host. Understood? So when it is restarted, this will become secondary. When it restarted, this will become a secondary. What FT will do? FT will again sync. There is a kernel port here, FT kernel port. It starts syncing like this, so that no downtime on a customer environment for FT VM. But other two VMs will, these two VMs will go for down, I mean, will be down, or it will go offline for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Okay, if you don't want to face, or you don't want to bear those 5 minutes or 10 minutes of downtime, you can enable FT. But FT is having a limitation. You cannot enable FT if your VM size is more than 4 CPU. Clear? Any questions? How to enable? Let's go ahead and do the lab. So what I did, I have cleared everything, whatever the VMs are there, this, that, I cleared everything. Go back to cluster, configure. Okay, fully automated DRS is turned on, and HA, proactive HA, both are turned on, right? If a fully automatic DRS is turned on, means on each host, if you go to configure, kernel adapters, management kernel adapter and vMotion kernel adapter, both are there. Okay, can I use this vMotion kernel adapter for FT as well? Fault tolerance logging. Understood what I'm trying to say? I can create one more kernel port if I want. I need to again assign a one more different IP. You want me to do that, or it's fine if you go with the existing kernel port and enable the feature? Let's test the FT with the available kernel port by enabling the FD logging. Once the testing is done, I'll explain a something different scenario which relates to the network. Okay, so what I will do, if I right click on this particular VM, this is proper Linux VM. Okay, and it has 1 GB memory, 1 CPU, and 6 GB hard disk. 6 GB hard disk. Okay, let me go to fault tolerance, turn on fault tolerance. You'll see error. If I'm trying to, how to enable the FT? No need to go to cluster anything. Go to any specific virtual machine, fault tolerance, turn on fault tolerance. It is saying the fault tolerance configuration of the entity host has an issue. vSphere fault tolerance requires the host to have virtual NIC enabled fault tolerance logging. This is mandatory. Okay, what I need to do? Go to host, select any kernel port, leave about these two. Select any of these kernel port. Let's take management, edit. Okay, fault tolerance logging enable means the same kernel port will be used for sending the fault tolerance logging data. Enable on all the hosts within the cluster. Okay. So now try fault tolerance. Turn on fault tolerance. Now you see no warning, nothing. Okay. So let's identify where this VM is running at the moment. This VM is running on which host? 01. Okay. Let me open the command line. Ping 192.168.10.2. This is the IP. If you look at, this is the IP. What I did, I have installed a Linux machine. I have installed the Linux machine and properly configured IP and all, persistent IP and all. Okay, see the Linux machine is. Not going because I haven't configured the DNS. Oh, it's still going, right? Oh, so fine. Okay, now if I look at, it's continuously pinging the Linux machine. So now what we need to do? Let's enable the fault tolerance. Fault tolerance enable. It is. Oh, my question is something else, right? So go to hard disk. It is running on LAN10. So if you're trying to place LAN10, you should get an error. Compatibility checks. Okay, no, it is not throwing any error. But the recommendation is please try to put somewhere else. Don't put it on the same data store. If the data store is gone, your primary, secondary, both will be gone. So place it on LAN20, acceptable. Now you see host one is not showing at all because host one is running with primary. It will not show you here. You cannot create a secondary VM on same host. So select host 2. Next. Finish. That's it. Nothing else. You see, fault tolerance. Start the secondary VM. Now you see, the virtual machine color has been changed and it is showing as a primary. But you see, there is a little latency because it is creating secondary VM and it is start replicating the data. Now, here you will see only one virtual machine, but go to cluster. Go to cluster, VMs, you see both VMs, primary and secondary. So now what it did, it has created a secondary VM. If you want, you can go to data stores. Okay, data stores, LAN20, you see FTVM, secondary VM is fault tolerance VM is replicating data over here. The VM is on LAN20 as well as VM is on LAN10 as well. You will see virtual machine is in two data stores. Also, virtual machine is in two hosts as well. If you go to virtual machines, you see primary and secondary. Primary is running on one, secondary is running on two. So what it is doing? It is syncing the data between primary and secondary. Primary virtual machine is this. From here, it is replicating the data onto secondary. It takes around 6 to 7 minutes based on the data. Okay, so you see it is progressing little slowly. What I'll do is I'll pause the recording. Okay, once this syncing is done, once this syncing is done, the properly configured VM, or if the totally synced primary and secondary both are up and running, then we will go ahead and do the testing. What testing we need to do? If I shut down host 01, if I shut down host 01, okay, you will see one ping lost here. Automatically the virtual machine which is running on host 02, host 02 secondary is running, right? This will become a primary automatically within a second, and no downtime in the customer environment. Let's see. It is syncing the data a little fast. Okay, I'll not pause the recording. Let's wait on once this is finished. Yeah, so fast. If you look at now, the warning message has gone. Okay, and if you look at both primary and secondary, both are powered on, and resource utilization is not showing up here, but however it is eating in the backend. If the system is powered on, it will eat something, right? Okay, now you have a virtual machine, properly configured virtual machine on the cluster. Okay, you want to initiate fault tolerance testing. How to initiate? If you go and shut down this host, go and shut down this host, that is not the HA. What you have to do? Go to main host and shut down the host directly. This one, right? This one. Even if you click shutdown, that is not HA. That is also graceful shutdown. So go to actions. Power off. Yes. Now go and see. You must see one ping lost and the machine started immediately. One ping lost and machine started. Okay. Visible, guys. And you see, 02 has become primary automatically. And you are accessing machine. Now you are accessing machine from 02, host 02. Okay, now you see again, host 01 is down, secondary is restarted in 03. Now syncing is different direction. You want me to show that picture? Primary is this, host 01, host 02, host 03. So what happened? Host 01 and 02, primary and secondary. So once this host is down, this become a primary, and this is restarted here, and this become secondary. Watch the same in the picture. Okay, now the warning message will go away after some time because the secondary is just now restarted. So the syncing will take some time. Now the syncing will not show in the front end because this is system initiated restart. So syncing will be running on the back end. Okay, understood? That is the difference between your HA and DRS and FT. So what happens if HA is disabled? Okay, if I disable HA and configure FT, will that work? FT will work, but secondary will not restart. Okay, normally what happens? Imagine, can I clear this one? Okay, so.
Sir, one doubt.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, in this, we have connected FT kernel port of host 1 and host 3 to a switch.
No. I have enabled it just for your imagination's sake. I gave you this picture. I'll That is the reason why I've clearly mentioned once the FT testing is done, we'll discuss some network terminology and some network scenario differently. I'll get this kind of questions. That is the reason why I clearly told you once the FT testing is done, we will do some discussion on the network again, because that's a confusing part.
Yeah. Okay.
So what I'm trying to explain here. Yeah, I got it. So let's clear this up. Clear. Now imagine you have one host. You have one virtual machine which is running, and you enable FT. Okay, and it is running on cluster. FT is enabled, and when you enable FT, secondary is created here. Fine, agree? Now you disable HA for some reason. You disable HA for some reason. Now what will happen if you disable HA? What happens if this host goes down? It's okay. When the host goes down, this is down. So this will automatically become a primary, and server is accessible. Customer is happy. But the problem is this VM will not restart automatically because HA is down. If this is not restarted, you will not have a secondary VM somewhere else. Secondary VM somewhere else. That is a challenge. So for that, you need HA to be configured if you want to enable FT. And DRS will make sure if the VMs are moving here and there, with the DRS, you can keep this primary and secondary. They will stay away always. That we already tested in anti-affinity rule configurations. Clear on this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let's wrap it up. Any questions on HA, DRS, FT so far? Any questions only related to these three? If this is done, we will discuss one more scenario on the network topology, because initially I told you, right, we need around 16 cables. We will use it for different purposes and all. So let's discuss that more theoretically once again, so that you'll get a clear picture on what's going on the network side. Okay, clear? If you have any questions, you can ask here. Then I'll stop the recording, and then I'll start the fresh recording for network scenario.
No questions.
Let me ask few interview questions then. If you don't have a questions because you are not spending time on videos, or you're not spending time on the scenarios, fine, it's okay. Guys, if HA is configured, okay, is there any downtime in the environment or not?
Yes, there is.
Okay, what is the
there is a downtime.
Okay, what is the difference between back to HA and HA? In proactive HA, there will be any downtime or not? In proactive HA, I'm talking about. In proactive HA, most of the conditions, there will not be any downtime, because proactive HA is something, it is predicting and proactively taking action to avoid the downtime. Right?
Yeah.
What I'm trying to say. And in DRS, is there any downtime in DRS?
No.
Okay. And there is one more DRS called predictive DRS. Is there any downtime in predictive DRS?
No.
Okay. And is there any correlation between vSphere distributed power management and HA? Distributed power management is feature of DRS that will be used to
yes.
save the power. Okay, there is no relation between your vSphere, HA, and DPM. Doesn't have any relation. Now let's move on to FT. Today what we discussed. Any questions on FT? Okay, FT. You need to have HA and DRS configured. If you want to configure HA and DRS, you have to configure with proper storage, proper network, and you need to enable kernel ports. You need to create a cluster and everything. If everything is in place, then only these functions will work properly. Otherwise, you will see unknown random errors or unknown issues will arise within your customer environments. So be careful when you're dealing with one-time setups. Okay. So
I have one question in FT.
Yeah. Tell me.
We can say we can only use till 4 CPUs that's a limitation. So basically if we create any VM which is having 4 CPU as a FT, so the same replica will get created into another host, and it will use 4 CPU there also. So basically it is using 8 CPUs.
VM can't primary or secondary. The calculation, you'll not combine both. FT is combination of primary plus secondary. It is not going to work in that way. If you have a VM running with 4 CPUs, you can enable FT. If you have a VM running with 6 CPUs, sorry, you can't enable. That's it. That's a simple logic.
So if we have enabled it in 4 CPUs,
don't calculate the secondary.
The same
what okay. I'm telling you, right? It is not working as per your thought. It is working as per VMware architect thought. Who designed this FT?
Okay.
Right? This is a combination of primary plus secondary. That this has become 8 CPUs, then it should not work. In that case, you must run with 2 CPUs. Okay. 2 CPUs plus 2 CPUs, 4 CPUs. Let me tell you one thing. Who will use FT first of all? Can you tell me who will use FT? Customer who doesn't want any downtime, 100% uptime, right? And zero right. downtime. Okay. Who will run mission critical 100% uptime or a zero downtime machine with 2 CPU or 4 CPU? Do you think so? The small website will have 2 CPUs or 4 CPUs, it's okay. But the big customer, big application, customer can't even bear one second of downtime, is running with 4 CPU. Do you think so? Right? So it's not a feasible solution for enterprise, large applications, mission critical applications running with high computing and high CPU, high performance machines. It's as simple as that. The limitation is there. Yes, limitation is there. If you are okay within the limitation, you want to play, use the FT. Okay. And as you said, it will not calculate the secondary. Secondary is the additional copy that is going to create. You are not going to enable the FT on a secondary, right? You are enabling FT on one particular VM. If you enable FT, okay, it will create a secondary. You are enabling FT, you are picking a VM. When you are picking a VM, if it is having greater than 4 CPU, you will not be able to enable it. As simple as that.
So when it will create a secondary, it will take the like we can say, it will take the hardware from another host, right?
Yes.
How it will utilize the hardware, like
same amount.
Compose,
the primary is using.
Same amount of hardware.
That is for that reason only. Yes. I have explained you. I said I have a Windows failover cluster with two hosts. Why I'm using two hosts? If one goes down, secondary should help me to serve the customer. The same concept, use it FT. That's it, nothing else, no rocket science. Clear?
Okay. Yeah.
That is the reason why initially I've explained you the Windows failover cluster concept. Why you need to, okay, if you have a two machines, definitely it will use two physical resources or two virtual resources, 4 CPU, 4 CPU, 12 GB RAM, 12 GB RAM. It will definitely eat, but the requirement is customer doesn't want to face any downtime. He is okay to pay for two machines. But what is the advantage in FT? In Windows failover cluster, primary and secondary, you have a two machines, two Windows licenses are needed. Two Windows licenses are needed, right? In FT, you have one virtual machine. When you create a FT, it will create a second machine automatically. Are you going to apply any license here in secondary? All right. Primary is there. It is replicating data and it is creating a copy. That's it. You are not applying any license. So with FT, one advantage is you can save some licensing when you compare with traditional Windows failover cluster. The limitation is Windows failover cluster, you can run or you can configure with 16 CPU, 64 GB RAM and 128 GB RAM machines. It will work, but in FT, it will not work if it is more than 4 CPU. That's a limitation.
Yeah. Okay.
Now let's go back and see. You see, both primary and secondary are green. Okay, both primary and secondary are green. That means, again, the syncing is done. So primary is running on 2, secondary is running on 3. Okay, if you want, you can simply go to primary fault tolerance. You can do test failover manually. Or you can do test secondary restart or migrate secondary or temporarily suspend data syncing between primary and secondary or simply power off the fault tolerance. Power off, the secondary will be deleted. When you power off, take some time, it's okay. The secondary will be deleted once it is completed. Okay, any questions? Any further questions on this? Good. Hello.
No, sir.
Yeah. No, no.
All right, yeah, good. So let me stop here.